the newest breakthrough in vaccine technology is messenger RNA, which turns human bodies into medicine-making factories. mRNA fights COVID by training cells to manufacture virus-like proteins that then trigger an immune response. Now, the same technology could potentially be used to fight HIV, influenza, even cancer. Our next discussion is a what's next catalyst joining me, who studied in the lab of the CRISPR gene editing pioneering Jennifer Doudna, of course, Nobel Prize winner. She's now teamed up with Doudna on a new venture to study the cancer-fighting potential of mRNA and other applications. I want to welcome Rachel Haurwitz, President and CEO of Caribou Biosciences, and I want to invite our audience watching on the platform to please send me any questions you have for Rachel by submitting them through the Q&A box on the right side of your screen, and I'll ask as many as we have time for. But Rachel, welcome. And as we digest every day, it feels like a new breakthrough, a new excitement surrounding CRISPR, as it's known. Can you just remind us exactly top level what CRISPR is?
Absolutely. Thank you, Caroline. CRISPR is a genome editing technology. It's the ability to go inside of cells and precisely change DNA sequences. I think of it as being like the Microsoft Word for the genome. Of course, it's not quite as sophisticated as Microsoft Word. Fundamentally, we're deleting genes or inserting new genes, and it's an incredibly promising new technology.
Incredibly promising. We just got a realization that over the weekend. I mean, the fact that I think it's the company, of course, Intellia, showed that it's working. Then their first few case studies, we're really starting to see the phase one trials bearing fruit. I know that you're linked to Intellia, you're a co-founder, but have not worked with that business for a while, but cheering from the sidelines, what did you see in that data set, for example, that got you super excited?
Yeah, it's incredibly exciting what they have done. So they are hoping to develop a treatment for amyloidosis. It's a disease where basically mutated or misshapen proteins accumulate and damage various organs. And what they were able to do was actually deliver CRISPR proteins into patients. They went to the liver and they actually got rid of that mutated gene. And after a few weeks, it shows that the levels of those mutated proteins are dramatically reduced. Obviously, this is incredibly early, but it's very exciting to think that CRISPR could be used to treat and possibly someday even cure genetic diseases.
Talk to us about the breadth of application here, because that's extraordinary that someone with this liver issue can live a normal life again. What illnesses are we thinking? What applications are you excited to see CRISPR really take on?
The application space is incredibly vast, really. Any organism has DNA, and you could envision using CRISPR to edit it for a variety of reasons. There's incredibly exciting research going on today to edit the genomes of plants to try to make them more tolerant to climate change. There's exciting work going on modifying the genomes of livestock animal to make them more resistant to disease. And of course, there's incredibly exciting work happening at a number of companies, including Caribou, to use the power of CRISPR to try to treat and fight a variety of diseases, including various genetic diseases, as well as various kinds of cancer.
Do you ever come across any concerns, backlash? A lot of this gene editing immediately I'm sure a few people cautious. How do you overcome that caution, Rachel?
Oh, it's such an important question. Obviously, this technology brings with it very important ethical questions and ethical implications. A question I often get from friends is, well, can't you just now make designer babies? So I think our company has taken a very clear stance. We have a policy that we will not edit human embryos for any purpose. That was a really easy answer for us to come to.
Caribou, of course, came out of the work that you did with prize-winning scientists that came up with CRISPR, of course. It's been really paid attention to all over the world. What was it like working with Jennifer?
I feel incredibly lucky that I got to do my PhD thesis work in Jennifer Doudna's lab. In fact, I was the first graduate student in her lab to work on CRISPR. I joined in what I feel like was the dark ages of the technology. In fact, at the time, there were, I think, maybe three scientific publications that had been published showing some sort of data on CRISPR, hinting that it might be a bacterial immune system that had some very interesting properties. So it took me about 45 minutes in my first day in the lab to read all of the papers in the field, get up to speed, and I've been working on it ever since. Obviously very exciting to see incredibly basic research that started with questions about how bacteria fight off viruses, ultimately leading to one of the most incredible new technologies in our field in quite some time.
Do you think the world understands what you see it as, the most incredible scientific breakthrough of our time? Do you think, how do you envision the world 5-10 years from now? Can you give us a sort of timescale of when I might really feel the effects of the technology that you've been working on so hard, when there was but 45 minutes of research when you first arrived?
Yeah, all of this takes quite a tremendous amount of time, right? If we think about the potential to use CRISPR for some of these therapeutic applications, of course, there's years worth of basic research in the laboratory that needs to be done first, and then ultimately a series of clinical trials to evaluate safety and ultimately the potential efficacy of these new therapies. So there's a lot of exciting early work ongoing, but it takes quite a bit of time to ultimately determine whether any of these applications will be safe and ultimately effective. So I think it'll be quite some time as we see all of these opportunities start to mature.
Quite some time being decades, less than a decade?
You know, I think on average, it takes about a decade to develop a new drug. So I hope that gives a sense for what these timelines might look like.
But do you think the year that we've just lived in, the fast forwarding of medical advances, what we've seen with Pfizer, Moderna, J&J, the vaccines, AstraZeneca, has that speeded things up at all? Or do you think that that was just so out of the norm and actually we need to return to a slower process?
I mean, I think there are many things that were quite unique and special about the experience that we have just lived through and are continuing to live through. I think we also learned a lot about the power and potential of some of these new technologies. As you highlighted in your introduction, obviously, this past year demonstrated the power of messenger RNA as a therapeutic or vaccine approach. And I think that will inform a lot of new opportunities for new drug or vaccine development going forward. I think maybe the world also began to appreciate a little bit more how drugs or how vaccines are made, and how complex some of the manufacturing can be, and how important that is in terms of actually being able to deliver these kinds of medicines or vaccines to populations around the world.
And how important it is to finance that. Intellia, I mean, just as someone who sits here working at Bloomberg on television talking about the share price reaction, for example, Rachel, you're someone who's leading a business at Caribou. Have you found that people are desiring to put money to work here, wanting to see it, to see this sort of industry grow, whether it be public money or private money?
I mean, certainly, I think Intellia in the past few days has demonstrated the ability to continue to raise significant capital to advance their opportunities. And I think that's a great example.
Can you return a little bit to the breadth of applications here, Rachel? Because what was so interesting about Caribou's journey is that you were really looking at agricultural applications to medical applications, and then you sort of fine-tuned it to really go into the focus on humans. But Where might we see the pace of change speeding up when it comes to agricultural applications too?
Yeah, it's a great question. There's obviously tremendous opportunity as we think about the pressure of climate change on crops, on agricultural livestock. And I think there's a really exciting opportunity to connect the dots between those challenges and the chance to use a technology like CRISPR to actually make these organisms, these plants, these animals more robust in light of climate change or the challenge of disease. So there's a lot of early work ongoing. And I think it's exciting to watch. Again, I'm, you know, a cheerleader from the sidelines on this work. And it's exciting to think about really being able to address some of these challenges at a large scale through genetic approaches.
What's so exciting about the conversation we're having is that we've got a global audience listening in right now, and we've got a question coming from Anhul Chahonchan, who's CEO of Pizza Hut Vietnam, asking, what will make this technology accessible at scale to more people? We're talking emerging market application here as frontier economies who we painfully now see behind in terms of the race of getting the vaccines to those people as wealthier nations such as the US and the UK hog it, basically. Rachel, do you think that CRISPR can in some way be a more equitable way of bringing healthcare to the world?
It's an amazing question. What I'll point to is that CRISPR has really taken over research laboratories around the world. It's a technology that can not only be used to try to fight diseases, but to also carry out really important basic research. And it's something that is now in probably nearly every biology lab around the globe. It is a far more accessible technology than some previous genetic technologies, and I think is really changing the face of research globally. And I think that's an incredibly important component of how we think about this long-term.